So I bought an Avid CNC machine, and I want to tell you why I got that machine instead of a Phantom CNC or some other machine. Price and capabilities are the bottom line on why I got the Avid, but I'm going to go into more details. I was really close to getting a Phantom CNC. You may have seen a video from Nick at Stated Woods comparing Avid to Phantom. I'll post some links if you haven't seen it, because it's something good that you should watch. And that video really influenced me. And to tell you the truth, I still might get a Phantom CNC someday. So Nick, if you see this video, don't get mad at me for making it. Now, to make it perfectly clear, I bought my machine myself. I am not sponsored by anyone. And Nick says the same thing in his video, but he's also a rep and a Phantom CNC dealer. So take that with a grain of salt with what he's saying. I'm sure he became a dealer just because he loved the machines. So I did talk to Nick before I bought anything and tried to just make the best decision I could. I also talked to Steven, the owner of Phantom CNC machines, and they're very helpful and helped me determine what I should get. So first off, the first thing you need to consider is, what are you going to make? If you're in a business that's just cutting plywood or signs, then buy a Phantom. It's just ready to go. You can throw in sheets of wood, you can get a vacuum system set up, and you can go right away, cut 2D shapes all day long. It's gonna be super fast and easy. But actually wait a bit till the end of the video, because I might have a better recommendation. Now, if you're using a CNC machine for its real potential and creating cool three-dimensional objects or custom furniture with wood joinery, then a Phantom may not be the right machine for you. Being able to have a vertical work table is really important to me. I want to be able to do custom joinery for furniture, and I want to be able to mount the pieces vertically and cut some joinery. I don't have a vertical table set up yet, but Jay Bates has an excellent design he did on his Avid, and I'll link to his video. Being able to cut joints is essential to what I want to do, and I placed a high priority on that. Now, the only pre-assembled machine that has a vertical work table is the Legacy Maverick. They look like great machines, but they are pretty expensive, and the spindle looks a little underpowered for the price. I seriously considered getting a Phantom S-Series machine and cutting up the table so I could have a vertical work area. But in the end, I thought this was a risky idea and I didn't want to do it. Nick told me that some people are using the Phantom TIR series to do vertical work, but that's a 46K machine, and I thought it was way out of my budget. So let's talk about the spindle. Avid has two spindle options, a 4 horsepower option and an 8.7 horsepower option. And the 8.7 horsepower option is really about 6 horsepower on single phase 220. So most people are probably running that, and I'll just consider it about 6 horsepower. The 6 horsepower one costs about twice as much as the 4 horsepower one. 4 horsepower one, about $2,200. 6 horsepower, about $4,400. And so I was trying to target a machine with around 5 or 6 horsepower. I find that 5 horsepower machines work really well, can remove a lot of material, and that's what I really wanted. When I was using my Tormach PCNC, I realized what was really important to me was to be able to have an automatic tool changer, or an ATC. This gets back to what you really want to do. If you're doing 3D cuts, and you're going to be using at least 2 different bits. You'll have one bit for a roughing pass, and another bit for a finishing pass. Sometimes you might even have 3 bits, depending on what you're doing. For me, it was time consuming to go and switch the bits a whole bunch. This is even when I had a power draw bar and I could just switch one tool to another tool really quickly. My main issue is that I might have been doing something else when the tool change needed to happen, and I just wanted the machine to do it. But it isn't just about switching bits. Having an automatic tool changer is also about precision. And if you're doing a lot of 3D cutting, you want to ensure your bit heights don't change from one operation to the other. When you have an ATC, the bit length never changes. All your tools are in particular tool holders, and you don't ever remove them from the tool holder. You don't have to manually touch off the tool and the bit again and again. So there's less of a margin of error. Every time you change a bit by hand, you put a new one in, you touch it off with your touch plate, you're going to introduce a margin of error, and one piece may come out slightly different than another piece. So the bottom line is I really want an ATC, but the Phantom option for a machine with an ATC started around $35K, which was, again, out of my price range. The great thing about the Avid machines is that they are highly customizable. You don't have to buy the 4 or 6 horsepower spindle from Avid, and there's a company called CNC Depot that makes ATC spindles. Their spindles are about 3 horsepower. Well, not about, they are 3 horsepower. The spindle sounded great, but it was a little bit underpowered for what I wanted, and they set me up with a Hiteco QD1F spindle, which puts out about 5 horsepower. This is perfect and exactly what I wanted, and it's been great. So the next big thing on my list was gantry height. That's the space from underneath your thing here, the gantry, to the table. And what this means is the gantry height is the limitation of how large of a workpiece you can put underneath your machine and cut something. And again, this comes down to what you want to make. If you're cutting plywood, the height really doesn't even matter. It's 3/4 inch. Don't worry about it. But I hope to do some timber frame joinery on my machine, and I want to be able to stick an 8-inch piece of wood underneath it. The gantry height of the Avid is 8 inches, but that's excluding the spoil board. So for me to cut a full 8 inches, I'll have to remove my spoil board, but I can do it. Now the Phantom and some other machines do have a leg up, as they have a height of 11 inches or more, and that would be great. However, I didn't think it was worth the additional cost to have that additional height. I did end up getting a 12 inch of axis, Z-axis travel on my gantry, so I can move up and down a lot, and maybe I can do some creative solutions by having my pieces way far in the back and sticking out and cut something way bigger than the maximum of 8 inches. Now, Avid does have a 12 inch gantry option. However, that's not really good for cutting a lot of wood on a machine. The 12 inch gantry is just too height and not rigid enough on a machine design like this. So it wasn't something I even considered. So I don't have one yet, but I have a hole in the front of my table for a rotary table that I plan on adding at some point in the future. Adding a fourth axis can really open up the possibilities of what a CNC machine can do. A lot of companies have the option for a rotary axis, but it's usually in an separate expensive type of package. Some of them do have it that you can add later, but not many, because your boxes have to be pre-wired for it, and there has to be some type of software on the system to be able to control it. I got the Avid electronics with an extra motor driver, so I can just easily add a rotary table when I get to that point of wanting one. This was another thing that was really important to me for what I wanted to do, and one of the reasons I decided to get this machine instead of something else. So I really like that Avid uses a PC with Mach 4 to control the machine. Having a large format screen to see what's going on is just a lot better than a tiny little pendant trying to control a machine. Phantom and a lot of other machines for their base price machines are controlled by a pendant. A full-size PC with a large display, you can see so much more information at a glance, and I find that very powerful. You can see your current position along with what tool paths are going to be executed, and you can see a virtual representation of the cut. You can have a lot of buttons that do different things that make things that are common tasks a lot easier and faster to do, and you don't have to like go through a pendant and flip through a ton of little menus to get to where you want to go. Now, Mach 4 is also great in the customizability that it allows. I can tweak it to my heart's content, but a lot of the modifications do require programming knowledge. Now, I'm a programmer, so this stuff is relatively easy for me and tons of fun, and I enjoy it. For other people, this can be really frustrating, confusing, and just downright impossible. I like to be able to run Fusion 360 and Vectric V-Carve on the Windows machine that's controlling my CNC. I can generate G-code from that machine, and it's just there. I don't have to copy it on a separate drive or anything, and then just instantly run it. This is just so huge for doing lots of iterations on going from one design idea to actually getting it to be cut and cutting it correctly, because I go back and forth a lot to get things just right. Now, I know this has limitations. Obviously, you don't want to be running your CAD software while the machine is running off of the same hardware, because you might have glitches or whatnot. So you have to take it with a grain of salt. For me, I don't have a dedicated Windows machine, so it's actually great to have a machine that I can utilize to do certain operations when the machine's not running, and I find it very valuable. The next important thing to me was how to hold down work pieces. If you're cutting a lot of plywood and sheet goods, then a vacuum table will save you a ton of time. Phantom's pneumatic rollers will also ensure you have a nice flat sheet of plywood. I don't plan on cutting a lot of sheet goods, nor do I even plan on wanting something like pneumatic rollers. Phantom doesn't have a way of removing these from their cost from their package, so it's just something you have to buy and not use, and is an extra cost that you would have to kind of just throw away. Instead, I wanted a table where I could use T-tracks to hold down my work. A lot of vacuum table machines don't have a good T-track system, and I found the vacuum table would just be a hindrance to a lot of the custom stuff that I want to make. So you can work around this. You could add another sheet of plywood or MDF on top of your vacuum table and create a T-track system on that. It's held down by the vacuum, but it's just more work they have to do, and if you're going to do that work, why not just get a different machine that does what you need to do? So for me, a vacuum table just seemed excessive and another motor that had to be running when I'm doing my work. You already have your machine running, which is probably consuming 20 or 30 amps, a dust collector, also 20 or 30 amps at 220, and then you're going to have your vacuum table probably sucking around the same amount of energy. So like 20, 40, 60, you could be pulling 60 amps. Just to run all these machines, and that's a lot of electricity and a lot of money. Now, if you're running a business, then it's all about saving time at the expense of more energy, and spending some money is okay on things like that. Building your own CNC machine is awesome, but it does take a lot of time. I love making stuff, and I actually like following a good set of directions. The Avid CNC directions are excellent and easy to follow. And I learned a lot about how the machine works by putting it together. I think this is fundamental to really understand machinery. But it was also a bit frustrating because I wanted to get the best accuracy that I could. So I spent a lot of time ensuring that everything was perfectly flat and perfectly aligned when I was building the machine. This took a long time. If you're a business, time is money, and getting a pre-made machine, pre-assembled machine, can save you a lot of time. One of the things that Nick talked about in his video was the stability of the machine, because it just doesn't have a welded frame. So the Avid machine being a DIY machine, you could make your own table, and that's what I did. I opted to make my own table out of steel. It's a lot heavier than the base aluminum one, and it costs about half as much. However, I do see a lot of movement still happening, so I may actually have to beef it up even more, maybe add some concrete to it, and potentially slow the machine acceleration down a bit so it's not so jarring. Money. Let's talk about costs, because that played a lot in my decision on what to get. And this decision is based a lot on my location, which is on the west coast of the United States near Lake Tahoe, California. Realize that I'm okay with saving money at the expense of spending more time assembling. Given that, the current 2023 base cost of these machines, Phantom CNC 4x8 S-Series machine, $20,500. Avid CNC with a 6-horsepower welded table, like what I did, $17,500. So that's a $3,000 difference, which isn't that big of a gap, especially considering the upgrades that the Phantom machine does give you. But the real kicker is shipping. An Avid can ship to me in California for around $700, whereas a Phantom comes from North Carolina, which is on the other side of the United States, and it would cost about $4,000 to ship. It was difficult to get an exact quote from them because it really depends if they could combine multiple machines being shipped to the West Coast at the same time. And $4,000 was the deal rate. If they could do that, it could cost easily $5,000 to ship a machine from one side to the other side. Now, $4,000 on a $20,000 machine is a 20% increase in the price, and that's huge. You would also have to rent a large forklift to move the machine, and on the West Coast, where I am, they're about $500 a day to rent. So these are pretty expensive costs that, if you're living in the Midwest or on the East Coast, might be a lot cheaper. So if you're really close to Phantom on the East Coast, it might make more sense for you to get a machine from them. But for me, if I'm seriously considering paying $4,000 or $5,000 to ship a machine, then maybe I should really start considering machines in the, say, $25,000 range. So what is comparable around the $25,000 price range? The Grizzly G0895 is a very close machine to the Phantom S series. It has a lot of the similar specs, but it's only around $24,000 with shipping. And the shipping cost isn't as nebulous as it is with Phantom because Grizzly ships a lot of big things all the time. Now, the Grizzly machine is made in China, but the truth behind the Phantom is that their frames and a lot of their parts are also made in China. They're shipped over on big container ship, and they are assembled in America, in North Carolina. I don't think this is a big deal, and I actually think that it's a great way to provide a great product at a lower price. But it's something that you might want to consider if you're thinking that you want a machine that's just 100% made in America. But the Grizzly G0895 is actually a lot better of a deal if you look into it a little bit further. They include vacuum pumps, whereas the Phantom has them as a $1,500 add-on. So if you're doing sheet goods, maybe the Grizzly is the machine to get, particularly if you're on the West Coast. Some disadvantages could be having to pay sales tax, which you might be able to avoid if you're buying a machine out of state. But even so, if you start to look at machines that are around the $25,000 price range, a lot more things are available that you could potentially buy. So I considered Laguna Swift, Shop Sabre RC Series, Camaster Stringer, just a whole bunch of machines. I did look pretty closely at getting Laguna Swift, but there would have been no ATC, and shipping was a lot cheaper because they're coming from the West Coast in Texas. The overall cost would have been comparable to the Phantom, so I felt like I was getting a better deal by not having to pay all that shipping. But the differences and the things the machine can do just didn't fit what I wanted to do. So I thought the Avid really could do what I wanted to do. Now, if you do want to spend $30,000 or above, there are more options to look at. I was really trying to keep it around the $20,000 price range, maybe up to $25,000 range. So that was my particular budget. My overall machine, I think I've spent a little bit over $20,000 getting it to the way it is. Now, in some upcoming videos, I'm going to talk about the customizations that I did to make the machine more accurate and to not have as much vibration, how to set up the tool changer, and how to make an awesome spoil board. And yeah, follow along. Let's see me do it.